fog I see visions of the things to be.
Don Nasberg has taken up video production in his retirement. At the age of 72, he enjoys recording scenes from nature, especially wildlife. But capturing scenes isn't a novel hobby for him. His interest in photography began years ago when he served in the infantry at Sandbag Castle in the Korean War. Between October of 1952 and September of 1953, he photographed shots of his army pals miles from his native Maine. Taking pictures at the front is far removed from the photography Don does today. But his memories are never far from his experience in Korea, where he served as a young man in his early 20s, in a war that took place more than 50 years ago. Don is still in touch with one of his army buddies, Ollie Seidel, from Washington, Minnesota. We asked Don about his war experiences.
Did you enlist or were you drafted?
I was drafted.
How old were you when you were drafted?
I was 22. Yeah.
What had you been doing since you graduated from high school?
Well, I was working in lumber camp, cutting logs in the Drew Valley and the Ellisville Plantation up by Moosehead.
And how did you find out that you'd been drafted?
Well, we'd work all week, go out on a weekend, so we went out this one Saturday. Took us all day to get out. We had a snowstorm. We had to shovel out to get out over the mountain, a big mountain there. We finally made it out, and then I had my greetings to go to the Army. Drafted.
What did you think when you read it?
I can't remember. That was a long time ago.
Well, can you just kind of vaguely remember what you felt when you read those words?
Well, I probably figured I should have stayed back in the camp. But I didn't. I said, well, they'd come get me anyway, so I figured that was it.
How did your family feel? Your brother and your father and your uncle and your grandfather? Do you remember them saying anything at all?
I don't remember saying anything, no. As long, I don't remember a lot of things I don't remember, no.
So, where did you train?
Fort Dix, New Jersey.
What sort of things did they put you through or expect you to do?
Oh, just basic infantry. Taking hikes, 20-mile hikes, and VRI circle there, and shooting a rifle and all that stuff. Just basic infantry stuff.
So you went to Fort Dix, and at what point did you then find out, okay, now you're headed for Korea?
Well, they had 16 weeks of basic training. So at the end of 16 weeks, you get your orders to go either wherever they wanted to send you. Some guys went to Alaska, some guys went to Korea, some guys went somewhere else, all depending on where they wanted you. So at that point in time, it was me and another fellow decided to go to another school he had for 8 weeks training for leadership trainer, so me and him went there. The rest of them left, and we stayed another 8 weeks. So we got 24 weeks altogether training.
And once you arrived in Korea, what did you do then? Where did they send you then?
Well, all they do is just have a place to go by truck from here, you know, one place to another, and they took you up to the line, where the line was, front line. Yeah, that's where you went.
And whereabouts did they send you?
Well, that's where they sent me.
To the front line, but where was the front at that time? Do you remember the name of the town?
Well, that sign, I think it was, yeah, it was Sandbag Castle. Where the front line was at that time was Sandbag Castle. Yeah.
So what year would that have been?
52. October 52.
What did you think when you first saw the place?
I don't remember, Brenda. I don't remember what I thought about it.
Did you look around and say, geez, there's a lot of sandbags around here, or what did you, what did the land look like, or the place look like?
It looked like it was just all mountains, like all, you know, not all big hills and mountains, what it was, and all rocks, rocks and ledges and whatever. And they had the bunkers were made out of sandbags, and right on the top. It was right on top of the whole hill up there. It was a big bunker, and I guess that's why they call it Sandbag Castle. Just give it a name, that's all.
So what was the sort of strategy at the time you arrived? What were they trying to do at that point?
Well, at that time, we already had the DMZ line there, and we were there, that's all. We were on the line, just stayed on the DMZ line.
Were you, like, there patrolling and watching, or were you launching any kind of offensives, or what were you doing?
Well, mostly you stayed on the line, but they also had patrols. You had to go on patrols every night. Somebody had to go on patrols and find out what they were doing, ambush patrols and stuff. And of course, they were sending in mortars and stuff, and of course, they'd try to run over you once in a while, try to get you out of there, and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. What do you remember of those times as far as the time you spent with the other guys? What did you do? Like, in your spare time, what did you do?
I don't remember, Brenda, really.
Did you play cards? Did you tell stories?
You didn't have a chance to play a card. You were up there, you're either patrolling or watching or something else. You didn't play cards or anything. You didn't go back anymore. You stayed right there. You was on there. And there were so many days, I can't remember now, it was 30 days or 60 days, and you went back for 30 days in the rear. But it's been a long time.
Did you have friends or people that you were with who were killed?
Yeah.
Who do you remember being killed?
No, I don't remember, Brenda. I don't remember.
Any from Maine that you know of?
No.
Of those of you who went out, what percentage were killed and what percentage came back, do you think?
I don't know. That stuff I ain't going to talk about, Brenda. I don't want to talk about that.
Yeah.
No, I don't.
No. I just wondered, you know, what were your chances of surviving in a situation like that?
I don't know what the chances would be, you know.
Yeah. How much do you depend on your Army buddies in a situation like that?
100%. They depend on you and you'll depend on them. They say you're fighting for your country. The only thing you're fighting for is to keep him alive, or he keep trying to keep you alive. That's you're fighting for. Mm-hmm.
And when you look back now on the experience, do you feel it was worth it, that you were doing something important? How do you view it now, 50 years later?
Well, it's pretty hard to say, really. I come down to it. If they prolonged that war, I don't believe I'd have been there, and a lot of them wouldn't have been there at the time I was there. But the Chinese wanted the prisoners back, and they wouldn't send the prisoners we had back, so they just kept prolonging it for two more years than they should have. That's one thing. I didn't know about that at the time, but I found out about it afterwards. At the time, you don't know anything about anything, really. They send you over there, and that's it, and you come back. And if you're lucky, you'll come back. If you ain't, you don't.
And how did you feel when they had the 50th anniversary celebrations for those who, or it was not really celebrations, but it was like a time of remembrance for people who had fought in Korea. What did you think?
Well, I think it was a good idea. Not for, especially for us, but for when they didn't come back, what it's for. It ain't for us. It's when they didn't get back, what it's for. Any of that stuff.
Now, there was one time when they let you go on furlough, and didn't you go to Japan or something?
Yeah, they gave you 5 days R&R in Japan, yeah.
What did you do when you got there?
Well, I don't think I'll tell you. Forget it. I'll tell me what I do when I get there. Well, I asked you what I did when I got there.
Well, I remember a story about going in a restaurant, and they had nice white tablecloths and stuff, and you had been living in the dirt and the sandbags and all that, and it seemed pretty good to see a white tablecloth.
Yeah. If Because I wanted a restaurant. They just, we landed at the airport. We flew over from Korea over to Japan. They had some some airport place out of the military. They had lights and tablecloths and all that stuff. And that was different.
So yeah. On the front lines, you didn't have even electricity or anything?
We had candles to bring to write with. If you're lucky, you had a candle to write a letter with. They had no electricity there. You couldn't run lights on if you had it.
This is Nathan Oliver reporting for Mr. Quist's welding classroom to find out how Justin Rockwell has been preparing himself for the VICA competitions after winning two events already.
Okay. It's